Hey guys, this is Mike Bergner, and you are listening to the Airborne Mind Show.
Welcome to the Airborne Mind Show. I am your host, Mizbah Hawk, and in these conversations, I like to explore what mental frameworks drive people to do what they do. I have strong feelings about talking to people who are deeply entrenched in and passionate about their work. I've always been drawn to ideas, art, and people that have a perspective that I can learn from. And so along the way, we're going to share and explore ideas that leave you with more context. You'll pick up things that might be educational, empowering, inspirational, or simply entertaining. And because you're listening, I have a free gift only for podcast listeners that you can grab if you head over to mizhq.com. Again, that's mizhq.com. Today's episode is brought to you by Revive RX. Revive RX is my recovery of choice. And this is because it is 100% clean, there's no BS, and it tastes absolutely phenomenal. My favorite is the Strawberry Recover, what I also call the pimp juice. I take 4 scoops after my workouts, and occasionally I'll do the Rebuild, which is pure protein, versus the Recover, which is a 2-to-1 carb to protein ratio. And if you want some educational material around supplementation and just nutrition overall, I recorded some short videos with Marcus Philly that you can get exclusively at theairbornemind.com. So check that out. And if you're in the market for supplements, head over to reviverx.com and use the code MIZ10 at checkout. Today, my guest is Mike Bergner, and every time I try to record this intro, I start rambling so much because I want to say so much about this guy, because to me, he's legendary, and so I'm going to try one more time, but I'm going to keep it brief. There's a lot on Mike Bergner's career as a weightlifting coach that you can get out there probably on other podcasts and other articles. He is a level 5 Senior International Weightlifting Coach. If you've ever taken a CrossFit Weightlifting seminar, he is the head coach of CrossFit Weightlifting. And you may have seen him around in a variety of places. He had a very successful career as an athlete, playing football for Notre Dame, and also as a weightlifter. But he's been a strength coach for over like 40 years, and he's now retired and retired a teacher, but still doing coaching to an extent. And so really what I wanted to get out of this conversation was, a little background on, him growing up and his career as an athlete and as a coach, but really talking to him about, some of the transfer that he's had from being an athlete, being in the United States Marine Corps, how has that kind of evolved into just the day-to-day life that he kind of lives? Who is Mike Bergner outside of the gym? What's important to him and his lifestyle? We talk about all that stuff. And then we also talk about how you manage the silence in weightlifting, which is such a... I love that portion of the conversation. So we do give you some nuts and bolts that you can take back and apply to your weightlifting game. But aside from that, I think this is just a very enjoyable conversation. I hope you enjoy listening in on it as much as I enjoyed having this. And more importantly, hope you do something with it. Mike, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
Yeah, I was just telling you earlier how, I remember back when I first kind of came across your work, it was like a video I saw on YouTube of you in people's faces. Like it was Dan Bailey, Rob Orlando, and they're lifting and you're like really kind of hyping them up. And I was like, wow, I need to have this guy like in my ear all the time. And I remember that was kind of the, you know, the first time I came across your work. And then I started, once I got a little bit more immersed into weightlifting and I watched the movie American Weightlifting, I saw that, you know, your gym was kind of included in that. And I've kept up with you since. And, you know, a lot of what you've done for the sport and what you've accomplished, I'm just really honored to have you on.
Thank you. I appreciate those kind words and thank you for having me on.
Yeah. I want to get into, you know, how do you feel like, you know, the inception of Mike's Gym kind of came about for you? Because when I look back to that movie, American Weightlifting, I remember seeing, you know, your gym was in there, and then we're seeing it, what it looks like today. And it's remained so simple, but so powerful. There's such a sense of community and camaraderie there. And, you know, that doesn't happen by accident. It takes some intention, it seems like, to mold something like that. So I'm curious, when did that kind of first come about for you, and how did it come about?
Well, my wife and I moved out to Bonzo, California from Carlsbad in 1985, and we were lucky enough to build a home. And in this home, we had a two-car garage that, you know, I think my wife had planned as a workshop. And so I was a strength coach at Rancho Buena Vista High School, and I had two young sons, Casey and Bo, and I would go to work at 6 o'clock in the morning to train athletes, and then I'd come home at 6 or 7 o'clock at night after a long day of teaching and coaching. And my wife didn't appreciate me not seeing the kids, basically. Mm-hmm. And so she suggested that we build a gym in the garage. And that took about 1 second to realize that I had something potential here. And so we did. We started building a gym. We started out with one platform. I was asked to speak at various conferences, and I got paid for it. So any amount of money that I made, I put right into the gym. And so I'd go to work at 6 o'clock in the morning before my children were up. And then I'd come home at 3:30 or 4 in the afternoon. And then the kids at school and the athletes would follow me home and train at my house. That way I'd be able to see my children and make them part of the gym lifestyle. And I'd be able to train the athletes as well. So we conquered, you know, made my wife happy, and we conquered the aspect of training athletes. But we just trained them here at my house rather than the school.
Yeah. And it seems like you've stuck to that over the years, because, you know, I'm sure if you really wanted to, you could have grown into a bigger space or gone to a different location and done all these things, because there's still a steady flow of people that are kind of coming through your doors and hanging out with you. What made you continue to stay kind of where you are and keep things going there?
Well, I really believe in fundamentals, and it's my philosophy is that, you know, you do drills and skills and you work the fundamentals, you build the foundation from ground up in order to make it better and a stronger weightlifter. And simplicity is in my ballpark. I mean, you lift, you know, you lift weights, your feet are on the ground, you're doing multiple functional movement patterns, you know, you work core to extremity, all the things that, you know, that CrossFit preaches. I didn't say it like that back then. I mean, it took Coach Glassman to make those definitions there, but I believed in yes to the fourth power, basically, and using free weights. So I could control that environment. Mm-hmm. And also the most important thing for me, I knew that my children would see me and they would hear me coaching out in the garage. And so when they were young, they would come out and watch. And as they got older, they showed an interest. They wanted to lift weights. They, you know, they wanted to do other sports, but they wanted to be protected from injury. And it was my philosophy that weightlifting was one of those sources that could help protect the kids from getting hurt. So we had them lift weights. They didn't have to become weightlifters, but we wanted them to lift weights for their protection if they were going to play sport. And then they just grew right into the gym. And the most important thing for me at the time and my wife was that we had the opportunity to control who came to our house and who my kids hung out with. You know, I mean, you, as they get older, they want to drive, they want to go pick their friends, they want to go, and you basically, you have control, you think, but really you don't have control. So in this environment, you know, they would invite their friends to come up and lift weights, and we got to scrutinize their friends to see what they were like, and I can honestly say that not at any time did they bring somebody up that was suspect, you know, that we wouldn't want them hanging out with. So it was just our little gym space, our family, our home. And we invited people in, and we still do invite people into our home and train them. And it's, you know, it's been a great adventure for us.
Yeah, I want to, well, we're going to loop back to your kids in a bit, but I would love to get your thoughts on, I mean, I know that I think it's on Tuesdays you have, you know, or maybe it's Wednesdays, you welcome anybody who's taken, you know, your weightlifting course to come through your doors and train at the gym. And then I've also seen a video you know, I don't know, you call it geezer weightlifting, right? Or geezer heads. And you invite people who are above the age of, you know, what is it, 70 or 65?
60, basically. That's when a geezer starts, is when they're 60.
Gotcha. Okay. So how did you come up with, you know, that concept? And then it seems like you're still doing it, and it provides a great sense of joy and fulfillment for you to get to kind of hang around all these guys, and you guys all get to throw down together. It seems like such a fun time.
Yeah, it really is. And it all started by accident. I mean, I had a friend of mine named Howard Schneider, was a retired doctor, and he would come over to my house on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, and the two of us would train. And then you know, we had such a good time, and we had a positive environment. We said, well, let's get some more people in here to see if we can train. So Howard invited his friends. I invited some of my friends, you know, and I ended up going to a special meeting, and I invited people at that meeting to, hey, you guys ever want to come and train, then come on over to, you know, to Mike's gym. We have a geezer workout going, and it's all scaled to your level of fitness. And, you know, in the beginning, it was very scary for the geezers to come over. They didn't want to be shown up, so to speak, by their peers. Mm-hmm. But, you know, it's a very, very, very non-threatening environment. And so we, gosh, at any one time can have anywhere from 5 to 12 or 13 geezers coming in and training together. And I write the programs, and I write them basically for me. But we have the scaling options that we put up on the board. And it's you saw the video, so it's basically a fun time of guys getting together and throwing down and giving each other a hard time and, you know, teasing each other and then sitting around afterwards and just talking. And it's the beauty of what we do is, like CrossFit, it's the camaraderie and the togetherness. And at our age, if somebody doesn't show up for 4 or 5 workouts, we get concerned, and we'll actually call them and find out if they're okay. And so I've put it out there to everybody that if you guys are going to miss a workout, you know, I get it. But, you know, for us, we do worry about each other. So let's just give me a phone call and let me know you're okay.
Yeah. You know,
so it's just kind of a mutual protection society, so to speak. And my wife runs a program on Tuesday and Thursdays called the Mambas. And Mambas is the same thing as geezers, except Mambas stands for Mothers Against Making Bingo Arms.
Oh, wow.
So they work hard, too. And it's just, it's same things. It's their girlfriends. And they get together and they go through an hour of sweat and, you know, and they really enjoy it.
Yeah. I mean, how do you think about, when you think about community and you think about the environment that you've kind of molded and just the general vibe that people get when, you know, they're in your gym and you guys are hanging out and talking together, you know, how can somebody extract some principles from that and, you know, develop or nurture their own community? Because there is certainly something to that, right? There's a way that you can lead, a way that you can, you know, pay attention to certain details that can really influence and affect how people are relating with each other and how they feel in that environment and all of that. So I'm curious for you, when you're maybe looking back at it now from when it first started to now, or you know, just your current thoughts on what community development can kind of look like. Does anything come to mind?
Well, it's my philosophy and my wife's philosophy that we want to lead or live our best life, so to speak. Mm-hmm. And, you know, first of all, we don't take ourselves too seriously. We don't charge for any of this stuff. It's all free. We invite people into our homes because we're very proud of what we've produced here. We want our friends to feel welcome in our home, whether or not they're coming to lift weights or they're coming to socialize. You know, I mean, last night we had a get together and all the geezers and the mamas were here, you know, meeting my son Bo's girlfriend and himself. And it was just kind of like a socialization situation, but it all came together through fitness and training and you know, feeling together and, you know, kind of encouraging each other to live their best lives. And part of that is, and it just comes up, it's just part of that is diet, it's nutrition, it's fitness, it's walking, it's getting up and breathing. And my wife and I have always tried to share that lifestyle with others. And we just feel like that helps us live our best life. And if people will buy into it, it helps them live their best life as well. At least that's the way we feel about it.
Yeah. I wonder, you know, you started off playing football at Notre Dame and you had interest in a wide variety of sports, but there seems to be a common thread between, let's say, football and weightlifting and golf and all these different, you know, mediums of like physical movement. Is there a thread that stands out to you that you feel kind of attracted you to pursuing those different sports?
Well, I think that, you know, first of all, you grow up in Southern Illinois in a coal mining community that, you know, that has four sports in high school for boys only. There were no girls sports. And football was a major attraction. And my dad was a football player in college and did very well. And so it's just kind of like the evolution. I was fast. I was explosive. So I got into football my freshman year in high school. I also played baseball, basketball, and I ran track. So I got to play four sports. The four sports that were offered, I got to play. So it was a very I'm a very explosive athlete. I'm short, but I could dunk a basketball in high school. So, you know, so I was kind of groomed to become that explosive athlete. And when I was good enough to get a scholarship at Notre Dame, but while at Notre Dame, I went in there weighing only 168 pounds. And my coach, who was Eric Parsegian, wanted me to be a little bit heavier. He wanted me up to about 180 to 185 pounds. And so he kind of led me down to Father Lang, our strength coach at Notre Dame. And Father Lang's, you know, with his encouragement and his education, he believed in the Olympic lifts. So he kind of directed me, because I was explosive, into the Olympic lifts, which there were three of them at the time. There was the clean and press, the snatch, and the clean and jerk. And Father Lang was one of these guys that would give encouragement, and he felt like the best encouragement was the dollar bill. And so if you could clean and press your body weight 10 times, he might give you $50. And this was back in 68 or 65 and 66. And you kidding me? $50 is a lot of money.
Yeah.
And so I became highly motivated because I didn't come from a wealthy family. And, you know, my mom and dad, you know, provided for us as best they could. But nevertheless, any kind of money that I got extra, then that was always a benefit. So it just kind of, I became a good clean and presser because of Father Lang. If he would have said, you know, we're going to give you $50 for snatching your body weight, hell, I would have worked hard on the snatching the body weight. But nevertheless, that's how it really happened. And then in the off season, that's what I did. Like, we competed. We had a weightlifting team. And after football season over with, we started competing at various contests throughout the Midwest. And, you know, we still keep in touch today. All of our Father Lang Alumni Board. We call ourselves the Flabbers, and we meet every year, you know, getting together at Notre Dame, or a guy has a cottage at Table Rock in Missouri, and we'll go down and visit there and get together and drink beer and wine and whiskey and just tell old war stories and just have a great time.
I love that. What do you feel, you know, when you were an athlete, and then, you know, when you were coaching a lot more, you know, there's certainly a way that you set up your lifestyle to be able to succeed athletically, or maybe it's professionally if you're pursuing coaching. But there's certain elements that, you know, need to kind of be in your day and how you structure your time and your environment and all of that. Is that something you thought about in the early days at all? Or did it just kind of happen naturally for you?
Well, I thought about it, but it was kind of an amazing evolution of it. I was convinced I was going to be, you know, a professional football player, obviously. And that was the path that I was going to move on. I never even thought about, you know, teaching or coaching, although my dad brought it and put it in my head several times. He said, you know, you'd be a great teacher and a great coach. You should follow that path. You'll always have a job. You know, you may not be rich, but you'll be able to provide for your family. And I kind of laughed at him. I said, are you kidding me? I would never want to teach or coach somebody like me. You know, I mean, I was hard-headed and aggressive. But nevertheless, when the professional realm didn't happen, then you know, I moved on and I joined the Marine Corps, you know, and then from the Marine Corps, I got a job teaching and coaching. And it was like I was teaching U.S. history and physical education and becoming the football coach. But I handled the strength activities within football. And I did that until I was probably 35. And then I had a school contact me and they wanted me to only do physical education and only be the strength coach. No football or anything like that was involved. And it was like, whoa, this is going to be awesome. So really, when I was 35 years old, that was my time that I kind of said, okay, I'm really going to get involved in the strength community. And, you know, I joined the NSCA and really worked hard on developing myself as a knowledgeable coach. I've always been a very motivated individual. I've always been able to make what with the old concept, I could convince the Eskimo to buy ice from me. You know, it's one of the things because of the Marine Corps, I'm very hard charging. I know what I'm going to say, when I'm going to say it. I know how to get into somebody's head to make them do exactly what I want them to do. And I hold them accountable. And so it was kind of a natural progression for me. I just didn't see it in the initial aspect, but it was a natural progression for me that I believe there was a spiritual body around me guiding me to the direction that I needed to be guided. And right now it's just, you know, it's just an outstanding, I've been blessed with this outstanding opportunity.
Has there been something that, now that you're looking back on this, something that stands out to you as, you know, if there's someone who wants to excel performance-wise or professionally, of course there's the training aspect itself, right? But maybe something that's unrelated that you wouldn't think of right off the bat that's like, you know what, this was a key piece that I needed in my lifestyle, in my day-to-day, in order for me to keep on going, keep on moving forward, and continue on that path to success. You know, does anything come to mind for you when you think of that?
Absolutely. And it's called education. Basically, it can be self-education. You could attend workshops, classes, whatever. But, you know, I'll be 72 years old on the 23rd of this month, and I am still learning. I mean, I would never, when I was 18, 19, 20, would ever think of myself going to workshops or, you know, getting on YouTube and watching technique or viewing films over and over again and coming up with a philosophy of that I built myself. And it's the idea of opening yourself up to everybody and every technique, and then formulating your own, you know, philosophy on whatever that may be. So study is extremely important. And then the next most important thing is don't be afraid to reach out and accept somebody or ask somebody to be your mentor. You know, I mean, that was very important in my development. And I just didn't know it at the time. I didn't consciously go out and say, I'm going to ask this guy to be my mentor. But I would go out and search several people. And I had one great friend that became a mentor. And then I had a great colleague by the name of Richard Borden, who was my instructor when I was getting my master's degree. And he just kind of took me under his wing because he saw how motivated and how passionate I was with wanting to develop as a athlete and as a coach. So, you know, I tell people, don't ever be afraid to ask somebody to help you out or ask questions. And that's why I give out my email. I give out my phone number. I tell people to contact me. And, you know, people are very kind, but they're afraid that, you know, they're going to be entering into your space and you may not want that. And for me, I've been blessed by who has helped me and the path that I've chosen. And if somebody's very motivated, then I really want to be there for that person as well and help them in any way I can. So, you know, A, study your butt off. You know, come up with your own philosophy based on a multitude of variables. I mean, there's things out there that you're not going to agree with, but that's okay. Study them anyway to make you the best that you can be and live your best life. And then be out there and don't be afraid to ask people for help, because 99% of the people that are there would be glad to help you in any way they could.
Yeah, it seems like when you study and learn from a variety of resources and people, you have this ability to connect ideas together. And to you, you may be able to see like, oh, I got this bit from Mike Bergner, I got this one from Travis Mash, and I got this one from, you know, Cal Strength. Like, but then at the end of the day, all of that comes together and it's this unique thing that's kind of driven by your perspective and your views as well. So I love that concept. And then same thing with mentors. I mean, it's amazing what you can absorb from just being around somebody, you know, and being around their day to day, or just, you know, how the mentor has an ability to pass down something that could save you months or years of time even. You know, it's like in coaching, it's similar. It's like you could try to wrestle with technique yourself, or you could have someone like yourself, you know, point out something and it takes you 45 seconds to do that.
Right. Exactly. And that's what we kind of pride ourselves on. I mean, if you came into my gym has got so many hook grip posters in it, you know, because I will choose, you know, what Nate puts out and I will put them on my ceiling. I got them on the walls, and it's all those things that basically I teach with my philosophy. You know, I mean, some athletes will bang the bar against their hips and they'll swing the bar out. And that's all well and fine because they've been very successful with it. And I accept that. But based on my philosophy, I believe this. I believe that the path of the bar should be maintained close to the body. I believe that the bar needs to go in the least line of resistance. And I believe, so I have all of those thoughts, and I then take the visual aspect of the pictures and the posters to coach and teach, so that with the understanding that 90% of all the people are very visual oriented, they're not auditory oriented. So I'll just say, look, this is the hips that I'm talking about. You know, that vertical hips, that's what I'm really talking about on this pull. And they're going, oh, I get it. You know, and so I don't ever poo-poo the banging off the hips type thing, but I try to show them why I believe that the bar's got to be put in the least line of resistance, and I give them cues and visual aids to see what I'm talking about.
I think that your ability to still, you know, have this curiosity to learn, you know, it's something that I mean, I can feel it, and I know other people can notice that as well. I remember talking to CJ Martin's mom, and she was kind of talking about you and how, you know, when you were at the camps, you know, just you could tell in your brain you're connecting so many things, and you're still soaking up things and learning, even though you might be there to, you know, teach some of what, you know, your own philosophies are. And then the other thing I noticed was, you know, Julian Pinot, he posted something around how he admired your ability to still be so open-minded and hear kind of what he had to say. And I'm curious to hear your thoughts around what you got from attending, you know, his workshop and his seminar. Were there any, you know, light bulb moments for you that you were kind of surprised by?
Yeah. I mean, the biggest one for me is the external rotation factor of the bar overhead. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've taught that for probably 50 years, you know, I mean, that's always been my philosophy. And, you know, I attended his workshop and he's talking about, you know, internal rotation, and I've never, ever taught internal rotation. And it was just a matter of perception is all it was. And when he and I spoke, because I challenged him on it, and you know, he says, no, coach, you're right. You have external rotation, but you have internal torque. And I'm going, you know, I'm trying to wrap my head around external rotation, internal torque. I'm not getting it. And so I guess about 15 minutes later, one of his interns came over and says, coach, take this PVC pipe, put it over your head. And he says, I want you to externally rotate that PVC pipe. Now I want you to try to bend that PVC pipe in half. So I did this and I bent it in half. He says, coach, that's internal torque. And the light bulb went off in my head. It was like, oh, crap. There's another way of saying something, you know, and it's like there's a very visual and a physical cue that I can use to help my athletes when they get the bar overhead and they're really punching up hard on that bar. Because and Julian put me in a position of external torque, and he says, now go ahead and hold that bar, and I'm holding the bar, and he says, and he pushes it back, and he pushes it back, and the bar goes back. And he says, now hold that bar up and try to break the bar in half. And then he pushes it back and it doesn't go anywhere. Mm-hmm. And there again, that was a physical, visual cue that he gave me. And in my opinion, hell, anybody's crazy if they're so set in their ways that they're not willing to make a change, even after 50 years, if it's for the betterment of the production of the athlete. You know, so Julian was a mind blower for me, and I respect him so much as a coach, you know, and there's guys out there. I mean, I'm a Olympic weightlifting coach, Julian Pinot. I mean, the guy, you know, Louis Simmons at Westside Barbell, you know, I believe in Louis Simmons and his passion that he has, just like the passion Julian has. It's just like the passion I have for Olympic weightlifting. Julian's got it for his gig. Louis Simmons has got it for his gig. And we're all very, very similar. And I just want to pick up the knowledge and learn from them so I can pass that on to the athletes that I'm working with.
Yeah, it's like you respect the intensity that these people have and the love that they bring for whatever, you know, it is that they're kind of pursuing. It might be different, but that intensity is very similar.
Yeah, the passion is everything. I mean, you get me talking about weightlifting, my wife just shakes her head. Well, we're going to be here for about an hour or two. It's because I can talk it all day long. I really believe in it. And I'm, you know, and even though I'm not actively coaching athletes that are USA weightlifting athletes, but Sage brings her athletes up here, and we just got back from the nationals in Kansas City, and it was the first time in 10 years that I actually went to a nationals and helped my daughter coach. So I mean, Sage is now the head coach, I'm the assistant coach, but the two of us together are so entwined in our philosophies, and have the three children. Sage is the only one that has pursued the Olympic weightlifting, coaching, building, and developing athletes to be on that national stage.
Yeah, I briefly had a chance to meet her just in passing while I was at Invictus. And, you know, it what you just said makes me think about the evolution of this all, right? It's like when you 50 years ago, when you started weightlifting, things were very, very different, right? And you've watched the community, the sport, there's so many things that you've watched kind of evolve over the years, you know, just like what you said with Julian kind of bringing this concept to the table that changes how athletes can view things and how, you know, this could transfer into Olympic weightlifting and how it could benefit athletes. Like little things like that. There's a ton of that, I'm sure, that's happened over the span of 50 years. I mean, what has been, you know, what you would say like the biggest change that you've observed just from back when you started to now, when you think about the evolution?
Well, I think back in the day, everybody did basically the same workouts. It was like, okay, if I want to get better in the clean, I got to do 5 sets of 5. And, you know, my first set is going to be with 135 pounds. My second set is going to be with 145 pounds. My third, you know, it's just that pyramid of, you know, you do 5 sets of 5 and your last set of 5 should be something that is fairly heavy. And then you just write it down and then the next workout, but it was always 5 sets of 5. There was never any variance for it. And there was never any variance for anything other than I'm going to do bench presses for my chest, and I'm going to do squats for my legs. I'm going to do deadlifts for my, you know, my strength. Then I'm going to do snatch, or I'm going to do cleans for my power. And snatches may or may not come in there because there wasn't a whole lot of instruction going on at that time for snatch. But then the evolution started changing. When I got involved with Olympic style weightlifting, I'm going like, well, I'm coaching this guy. His name's Kent Durso, and he's really great on the snatch, but he sucks on the clean. Why would I give him 5 sets of 5 on the snatch when he's good at it, when really he needs 5 sets of 5 in the clean because he's bad at it? Mm-hmm. And then I started playing around with, well, 5 sets of 5 is good, but why not 5, 4, 3, 2, 1? And lift the heaviest weight as long as he can recover. And can I have 5 days a week of workouts if I vary the workout and the structure and the intensity, or do I keep it at three days a week? Because back in the day, it was only 3 days a week. So I think for us and for me, at a very young age, I started finding that I'm going to develop my programs based on the needs of the athlete. If the athlete's weak, then I'm going to give him 5 sets of 5 because I believe 5 sets of 5 is a great program. And if he's weak in the legs, I'm going to give him 5 sets of 5. And if he's not weak in the legs, then I might give him 5 sets of 4, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, whatever. So I would just vary it according to the athlete and what I saw the athlete and what he needed. And I think that's the biggest evolution that I think that started in the 60s. I mean, and in reality, in the 60s, no one lifted weights. Right. I mean, it was one of those things. My dad was he was a coal miner. He was a dairy farmer, and he wanted me to, I shoveled coal. You want to get strong, boy, pick up that shovel and shovel out this coal bin. You know, want to get strong, boy, bale this hay. You want to get strong, you know, take the horse crap and cow crap and throw it into that's the way we got strong, was through hard work. And it wasn't until I went to Notre Dame that Eric Parsegian taking me down to Father Lang's and wanting me to physically lift weights so that I could get my body weight from 168 to 185. That's when it all started. And I think that happened also with Nebraska with, what's the guy's name? I forget his name right now, but he was basically known as the father of weightlifting. I'm just having a brain fart what it is. But this guy, it was the first strength coach at the University of Nebraska, and he built a program there. But I say that it wasn't him. It was really Father Lang that built that program, because Father Lang in the 50s had a national weightlifting championship team at the University of Notre Dame. They just – The lifting was just few and far between. That's all it was. So, you know, it's to see where this has come from 5 sets of 5, doing the bench, the squat, and the deadlift, to doing snatch balances no dip, to snatch balances with a dip, to rack jerks behind the neck, You know, all of that comes in based on what the athlete's weaknesses are and how you can incorporate exercises into their program so that they won't be weak in that area.
Yeah. Well, and this is maybe it's a tough question to just kind of generalize. But at the same time, I'm wondering if you had to give a range for, you know, what percentages an athlete should kind of spend a majority of their time at, meaning, yeah, I understand, you know, when you're getting closer to competition, of course, things start to ramp up a bit. And when you're deloading, things, you know, hang out a little bit lower. But when we kind of look at the span of maybe a 12-week cycle or the majority of someone's training, what is kind of that sweet spot where people should be, you know, getting in those really good reps and refining technique and is valuable in your eyes?
Yeah. Well, I think it's like anything else. You start out and you evaluate your strengths and weaknesses of the athletes, and you put them on a, you know, 12 to 16 week cycle. You know, in reality, if the athlete's a football player, he's going to be trained one way, and if it's a basketball player, he's going to be trained another way. If it's a track and field athlete, he's going to be trained another way. If it's a CrossFitter, he's going to be trained another way. So you've got to be able to break down what the needs are of that athlete for the sport that they're going to be working on. And for me, the beauty of CrossFit, it's a very GPP-oriented, you know, program. I mean, there's so many things within the CrossFit world that go on now that have developed extremely explosive Olympic weightlifters that started in CrossFit that are now being touted and going to world championships. You know, I mean, these people start there. And I think the idea of, you know, being sport specific, but understand the GPP of it, and understanding that when you start a program, you've got high volume, basically low intensity, and then you work this up into the pyramid where you've got low volume, high intensity, and that's timed in with what you're looking at as a major contest that it may be. If it's an Olympic weightlifter, it may be the national championship. If it's a football player, then that football player is working up to the beginning of their football season. And then during that 10-12 week football season, then that athlete is going to be on a sustainable, you know, in-season program. So it's all geared towards this. And then it kind of goes up, and I'm going to do, you know, medium volume, medium intensity to sustain what I've built up through that time period. And that's all different for a 10-week athlete in football or a 12-week athlete in football to maybe a 15 or 20-week athlete in basketball or track and field. So you have to develop the athlete for the sport with which they're participating. The beauty of what I like is what CrossFit is bringing to the table in their GPP orientatedness, right? Their programming is based on fitness. It's, you know, functional movement patterns done at high intensity, varied movement patterns, you know, I mean, constantly varied functional movements done at high intensity. I mean, there's so many things that you can wrap your head around that for all the sports. And then with football, as you get there, or basketball, you get there, you can bring it down to more specificity for that sport.
Yeah, that totally makes sense. And I guess this maybe ties into my next question. It's like, okay, we've watched weightlifting evolve to where kind of it is now. And then I often wonder, wow, what could it look like in 10 years, 20 years? I mean, the community aspect really has seemed to have grown within, you know, just competitive weightlifting. But then you're right, aside from that, there's this whole, you know, other group of people that maybe aren't really even doing it for, you know, sport specific reasons. It's just a recreational thing now. It's like, I really just love the snatch. I really just love to clean, and I want to get stronger at it. And so what I'm wondering is, like, you know, for especially for beginners and, you know, maybe a large variety of people staying at, you know, because when I think of myself when I was weightlifting and when I was hanging out above like that 80% mark for me, and I was doing that, you know, often and consistently, you know, it was something that was really hard for me to recover from. But I found over time, it's like, well, you know, hanging out in like the, you know, I want to say like 70, 75%, 80% range, there was still a ton of value there that I was able to take away, and really progress still can come from that. And you're right, it does, of course, change throughout a build or cycle. But I often found it's like, wow, there's this perception that like we need to be heavy all the time. And in fact, it's like actually the good reps and whatnot are drilled at such a, you know, a much lighter percentage or weight.
Yeah. Yeah, I absolutely. I mean, I agree with you 100%. First of all, if it's not fun, you shouldn't be doing it, you know, and you don't need to be heavy unless you're going to be an Olympic weightlifter that's going to compete in the Olympic Games or national championships or world championships. The beauty of what CrossFit's done is been able to take people like me, that's even though I'm a geezer, I can still go to the gym and do CrossFit and I can still snatch. I mean, okay, maybe I'm snatching a 7 kilo bar. It doesn't matter. I'm still snatching. I'm still doing the movement patterns. I'm still taking that bar through a full range of motion, and I'm having fun doing it. And you know what? The snatch feels good. It feels athletic. It makes me feel good about myself, and it's fun. You know, it's a lot different than going and training, you know, 15 workouts a week, you know, in the Olympic lifts, and I'm training 3 days a week or three times a day. One day, the first workout I'm snatching, and I'm snatching fairly heavy. Your body has a hard time with recovering. And I will tell you, I've always said this, there's no such thing as overtraining, but there is under recovery. Mm-hmm. And that's the biggest nemesis that any athlete can have. So I'm with you. I'm that guy that, several years ago, I wrote a paper on grading maximum effort the correct way. And it was through a point system. And it was like, you and I are competing against each other. I'm your competition, and you. I weigh 250 pounds, and you weigh 175 pounds. So I snatch 250 pounds. I snatch body weight. You snatch 200 pounds, and I get a score of a 6 on my 10-point scale, but you get a score of an 8 or a 9 on the 10-point scale. You win the contest, even though I lifted more weight. You win the contest because your technique and everything through that 10-point scale was met. So you win the gold medal. And it was amazing to watch my kids, my students, gravitate towards that, because the little guy could compete against the big guy because he had good technique. The big guy got pissed off because he lifted the most weight, but it was ugly. He got a 4 or 5 on the technique scale out of a 10. And but he learned a lesson too, because I better reduce this weight. I can keep my score of an 8 and do 210, and I can beat this little turd, you know, this little guy over here, right? Mm-hmm. Because he beat me at 200. I need to back it off and come down with an 8 or better to beat him. And they did that, and then eventually both athletes went up the scale, and the 250 guy ended up getting an 8, and the 200 guy ended up getting an 8 on 230 or 240. So, I mean, everybody wins, you know, doing that. And I believe that that's the way I run my gym. I do not let people go up in weight unless the technique is good. And it doesn't matter what they're doing. It could be CrossFit. The technique could be ugly, and I wouldn't let them go up in weight. I'd make them scale it back down to that point where they're getting an 8, 9, or 10 on their score.
Yeah, I love that system, and I would love to link that up in our show notes, that article. You know, something I'm thinking of is golf, and then also Olympic weightlifting. You know, there's so much focus and silence and precision, coordination, balance, like all these different elements of athleticism that go into, you know, a golf swing or, you know, a snatch or a clean. There's these parallels there. And often I think about, like, How do you manage the silence, right? So whether it is when you go up to lift a heavy weight that makes you nervous, and it's just in training, you know, it's something challenging for you, or you're competing and you're on the platform, you know, it seems like, well, it would be productive if you're not thinking about anything during the lift, right? And you're able to just focus in the moment and the sensation of effort and go through that. But at the same time, I understand that's easier said than done, right? To just kind of filter out all the noise and focus on the lift. So I'm wondering for you, what do you recommend to people when it's like, when you're doing the snatch or you're doing the clean or you're lifting, you know, from the moment the bar leaves the ground to finish, how do you manage the silence that's in your head? Any recommendations on that?
Well, first of all, you know, we train like that. We train when it's chaotic. I want my athletes to be in a situation where music's blaring. I want people to be walking around, and I want them to be able to focus away from what's going on. But the visualization process that has to take place prior to the movement pattern is so succinct. You have to dial that in, and you've got to just get in your head with that, regardless of the noise that's coming around you. So we train with noise. I want athletes to be distracted and still be able to focus in on what they're doing. And that's a challenge. I mean, I've always said this, there's 90% of all missed lifts are attributed to the feet, the standard of the feet, which is just like golf. At the same time, that 90% of the 90% is right here. It's within the head. You've got to be able to control that aspect, and you've got to be able to see the lift in a very positive image. If you see the lift and you have negative self-talk, you're going to miss the lift. There's not a very good chance of you making that 90%+ lift. You've got to get it in your head. You've actually got to be able to see what is taking on. And I always like to tell the story about Dragomir Sorosian before the 1984 Olympics or whatever, that he was he got injured about a month before the Olympics, and he's going to the Olympic Games for Romania, and he got so severely injured that he was in the hospital for about 3 weeks, and he came out of the hospital, went to the Olympics, and won a bronze medal in the Olympics. It was in Seoul, Korea. And the one thing that he said is that while he was in his hospital bed, he actually put himself mentally inside the Olympic Games at the platform, smelling the smells, chalking his hands up, smelling the chalk, watching the chalk go out of his hands, walking up to the bar, setting himself up for the bar, and he would see himself do a positive, good, clean, 10-point snatch or clean and jerk. And he did that for 3 weeks with no training whatsoever. So mentally, it is a training process that you have to deal with. You have to deal with that, and as a coach, it's up to you to understand which athlete is strong mentally, which athlete is not strong mentally, and you've got to give that athlete drills, mental drills, to make them be able to focus on what the hell they are focusing on without that outside noise. It just doesn't happen. You know, there may be somebody out there that can walk into a room and just kind of everything is going slow motion and they don't hear anything. That's very, very seldom that happens. But you have to take the time to train that. And in my gym, I mean, I took this after, you know, Tiger Woods' dad. He used to poke him in the butt with a golf club as he's addressing the bar or addressing the ball. And I did the same thing. When my athletes were addressing the bar, you know, I'd go over and hit him in the butt, hit him in the shins. You know, I'd run in front of them all of a sudden. And that training taught them how to just get in the moment and quiet everything down regardless of what was going outside of you. And I would say we had probably 70, 75% success with doing that. Not everybody's going to be able to do it, but you as a coach, it's very important for you to be able to see that and work that towards the athlete.
Yeah, I love that because this is one of those things that I remember you know, when I was competing myself, thinking about like even some of the failed moments, right? Like thinking about what it's like, because the bar is going to feel heavy, right? But associating that feeling in your head of like, you know, there's some fear that it might bring up, but getting comfortable with the fear before you even go on and you actually hold the bar. It's like doing it in your head. And then I remember hearing from different people like, well, there's one way of you visualizing, you know, in first person, right? Which is like, okay, I'm walking up, I'm chalking my hands, I'm holding the bar. And then you can also do it, you know, in third person where it's like, you know, Nat from a hook grip is filming you. What would it look like if it was perfect? And all those little nuances seemed very helpful because it's just like getting reps and reps and reps in before you even touch a bar.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. It's a critical aspect of your development, you know, and there's something like Ilya. I mean, he said 190 kilo snatch. I mean, he goes over and chalks, walks up, attacks the bar immediately. There is no coming up, waving your hands, looking out. It is, everything's done. He's going to go lift it right now. And that's just the way he does it. And I know he's practiced that 1,000 times. In the gym, he's practiced it wherever. And it works for him. It can't work for everybody else. You know, I've got an athlete right now in Sage's team that she's got potential greatness in her stores, but she can go to a weightlifting contest and she hears everything. She hears this person over here. She hears this person over here. And she's focusing on what they're saying. Are they talking about me? Are they doing this? And we're working hard to break that from her, you know? And I will tell you the best job I ever did coaching was I had an athlete at a national championship. And this athlete was very hypersensitive. She was like looking around at everything. And you could tell her breathing started to be, you know, short and shallow. And it was like she was very nervous. And I put her in the middle of the warm-up platform. And I set her down and put a white towel over her head and played classical music for her while she was warming up. She had no recollection of what was going on the outside. I quieted her mind, and the classical music was opera, for God's sake.
Yeah.
And it just worked in quieting her down, and she went out and won the national championship.
Wow.
So, and you know, and there's so much negative thought behavior there, because you are going to lift weights. You're going to try weights that are, you know, maybe they are too heavy. But it's up to me to put you in a situation for success, number one. And that means the training program. If I get an athlete that's mentally, you know, challenged with that kind of thought process, then I want to put them in their training in a thought process where I do maybe tempo pulls at the deficit or tempo pause pulls at the deficit with 5 to 10, 15 kilos more then they've snatched and they've cleaned, so that weight feels, oh my goodness, that's a heavy feeling. But I develop them in those slow tempo pause, slow tempo 6 second to 10 second lifting through the patterns. And then all of a sudden when they come into the contest, they're taking 100% or 100% plus 1 kilo. And that weight now, because I've addressed it to 10 to 15 kilos with good form off of a deficit, they're going like, well, hell, this feels light. And if it feels light off the ground, plug, that automatically makes them feel good through that pattern. As soon as they pick that bar off the ground, you don't want them saying, oh, shit, this is heavy. You want them to say, oh, yeah. And it feels light. That microsecond, that little bulb that goes right off between the ears, I got this. That's what you're trying to develop in that athlete mentally. So it's up to you to put them in that situation in the gym so that they're lifting heavier weights with good technique, but not the full pattern, but off the ground. It's like, oh, crap, I got this. You know, that's what you're – but that's your job. That's your job as a coach to do that.
I love that. This is so valuable to hear from you. And, you know, I want to switch gears a little bit and get into, you know, I know we touched on your lifestyle as you were coming up as an athlete, as you were developing as a coach. And, you know, now that you're retired and now that you are, you know, getting to spend more time on the things that you want to do, how do you kind of view, you know, how you've set up your life now, you know, and how does that feel for you?
Yeah. Well, we've been very blessed. I mean, honestly, my wife and I both worked. I mean, We're both school teachers, so we had to pass a hat to get a cold beer, you know, honestly. I mean, but we were very steadfast in wanting to be debt-free when we retired, and we wanted to be able to travel. We wanted to be able to, you know, spend time with our children. We didn't expect any of them to be here in Southern California. We knew that they were all going to be going out to wherever they go, but at that point, we wanted to be able to, you know, financially be able to afford to go to their places, or financially be able to afford to bring them back home to our place as well. So we've been, you know, at a very young age, we started investing properly. Even when I was in the Marine Corps, you know, USAA and the Navy Federal Credit Union, I always took a certain amount of money out of my checks. And then when I got my first teaching job and we got raises, we always said that we would take half the raise, put it towards our investments. And then, you know, then basically with CrossFit, I mean, again, I was blessed by Glassman coming down and taking a course. And I was lucky enough to become the subject matter expert for Olympic style weightlifting within the CrossFit community. And that just even set us up better to be able to live the lifestyle that we have. But, you know, make no mistake about it that, you know, you retire from what you're doing. It's not all peaches and cream, because you, even though you can do things, you still have to go out and do things. You got to get your butt out there. I mean, I get bored very easily. So for me, I mean, we got the geezer workouts Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. You know, and then I'll go to the beach and I'll walk. I'll go visit CrossFit boxes because I want to keep myself busy. And if I'm back at the house at 3 or 4 o'clock in the afternoon, it's like taking a job, right? Mm-hmm. And my dad taught me that. My dad retired at 65, and he'd get up in the morning and he would go to the golf club and he would have breakfast with his buddies, and he'd go out and play 9 holes of golf. And then they'd come back in and play cards, and then he would have lunch, and then he'd go out and play another 9 holes of golf. And then he would go home and take a nap and then work in his rose garden. And then him and my mom might go out and have dinner and play 9 holes of golf. But he did that like 5 days a week, and that became his job that kept him busy, you know, and I think that's the biggest thing that I think that we have available for us, is that the geezers, this is our way of going to work every single day. You know, this is our work time. So it's in the gym 3 days a week, but it's walking on the beach 2 days a week, having breakfast, stopping by a CrossFit community and saying hello. Maybe they need help coaching, give them that. And then, you know, then continue on with your day.
How about your rocking chair? Does that symbolize anything for you?
Yeah, we're geezers. We're getting old, you know, and it's like my wife put it out here, and then I know we were going to throw it away. And it was like, I don't know, I might have been Miracle on the Hill kind of had a little documentary on, you know, the rocking chair geezers or whatever it was called, but they kind of took pictures of us sitting in the rocking chair. And so rather than throwing it away, we just kept it. And so it's like there, but, you know, but now everybody uses it. It's not just the geezers. It's the young kids will sit in the rocking chair because it's kind of a status now of the gym. You know, it's there. It's a geezer gym. It's not the Olympic weightlifting gym that it used to be, but it's still an Olympic weightlifting gym. So we're going to keep it, and we're going to sit in it too. You know, so
there you go. Recently, you know, a client that comes to our gym, he himself has been very excited about developing his own Olympic weightlifting, and you know, he loves kind of putting in the reps, putting in the work, thinking about it, analyzing it. Like, he's enjoying it and soaking it all up. And, you know, his son, who is, he grew up kind of as a gymnast. He's still like a teen, you know, he's a youth, but, he himself started to kind of develop an interest in wanting to go to a local weightlifting gym and jumping in and just kind of dabbling in it. And as his father was telling me about this, it's like, he was so excited to hear this, but at the same time, you know, to his son, he's not like pushing him to go do it, or, you know, he's making it feel like this is your idea, like go have room to play and grow and have the space to pursue it if you want. And it's been cool to hear these update stories from him that's like, oh, you know, he's seeing progress within himself and the training he's putting in. He's like, you know what? I wanna make it to nationals. You know, I just gotta get my snatch to this number or get right. my clean to this number. And these possibilities are opening up for him, and he's enjoying being around a community that, you know, he gets to watch other lifters. And so I'm curious for you, you know, how does it feel now that, you know, your kids are doing all these different things, and some of them have stuck with continuing to pursue weightlifting in some way, shape, or form? That must be exciting for you.
It's extremely exciting for me because every one of them has been a national champion. And it's like every one of, regardless of the sport. I mean, Casey, he dove into it full. I mean, he was a 2008 Olympian. He was the guy that this is what I want to do. He didn't play any other sports. You know, Bo was a national champion, and he played water polo. He played volleyball. He did all these things that he liked. You know, Cody, who's a firefighter that still trains and coaches at CrossFit, he was a baseball player. That was his sport. You know, he played football once, but didn't find that he liked it. So he selected that. But they used Olympic-style weightlifting to help them within the sport, right? And, of course, Casey trained specifically for weightlifting. Sage, you know, I mean, she was a national champion, but the same thing took place for her. She played water polo, field hockey, volleyball. She did all these sports until she was a sophomore in high school. And then she came over to my school and she concentrated only on weightlifting. And she ended up getting a college scholarship up in Northern Michigan from USA Weightlifting. So it's very important to understand that you as a father or a parent of a child that has the interest, then you want to generate that interest and make it available for that child to pursue it. If they don't like it, then don't be there pounding them in the head, telling them to go work out. You know, you've got to be able to support that child in whatever that they want to do. Luckily for us, we had the gym. It became a situation where, look, if you're going to play baseball, we want you to do the Olympic list so that you can become more powerful, more explosive for baseball. Do you have to compete? No, you don't have to compete. But you do have to work out to protect yourself and to become more powerful. That's the only thing that we absolutely made our children do. They had to lift weights if they were going to play sport. If they weren't going to play sport, it wasn't a big deal. But they chose to play sport, and that's, you know, that's what my wife and I, who we worked as a team to make sure that everything out here in the gym was my responsibility. After the gym was her basic responsibility. I supported her in the house. She supported me in the gym. So when the kids would come and piss and moan about dad being too hard on them, then mom would say, you know what? He's hard on you because he cares about you and he wants to make sure that he treats you harder than the person that's coming up, you know, behind you, because they're going to see him treat you hard, then they're not going to feel nearly as bad when he yells at them as well, you know, yeah. So or gives them positive encouragement.
Yeah, that's amazing. You know, what I'm thinking of is you have done a lot of hard and difficult things that require, you know, a lot of discipline and grit in your life. You know, you were in the Marine Corps, you played football, you competed in Olympic weightlifting, you were coaching, like all those things require a certain amount of, you know, there's a certain characteristics, right, that go into each of those areas. Has there ever been a time where you felt, you know, fear, you felt scared, and you felt like your back was kind of against the wall and there was nowhere to kind of go but forward? Did you ever encounter any of those moments? And if you did, does one specifically stick out to you? And how did you kind of handle that?
Well, yeah, of course. You can't go through life, I don't think, without having that kind of situation happen to you, you know, I mean, it's not what happens to you that counts, but what you do with what happens to you to move on. You know, I mean, I was an All-American football player in high school, and I went to Notre Dame. And when I walked on the campus of Notre Dame, I was just another Joe. I was just another guy. I had to compete for the position that I was going out for. And it wasn't, you know, it wasn't Mike Bergner, the All-American from Marion, Illinois. Now it became Mike Bergner, whoever he is, and he's trying to make this football team, and he's competing against Tom Shane, Tom O'Leary, Jim Smithberg. He's got all these guys he's competing against. And it was like, oh my God, what am I going to do? What if these guys beat me out? I mean, Jesus. And it became, oh crap, I'm afraid of failure. So I had to work through that. So it was my philosophy that I'm just going to work 10 times harder than anybody else. I'm going to study. I'm going to practice. I'm going to look at my playbook, and I'm going to be right there when things need to happen. And then if I'm not selected for the position that I want to be selected from, then I know that I've given it everything that I've had to make myself better. So who loses? No one loses in that situation. You just have to deal with it egotistically. Mm. And that was the one thing that I tell people all the time. When you walk into my gym or you walk into a competition, you have to leave your ego at the door, and you got to pay attention to the task at hand. And I thank God, because of my mom and dad, I am a highly motivated individual, and I'm very passionate about certain things. Now, I could give a shit about physics. I could care about anything else other than force times distance over time, the definition of power. I could care less. But those things that I'm very passionate about, then I'm going to give it 1,000%. And if I'm going to take it on, then I have to do it the best of my ability. And if it's not the best, then I got to look in the mirror and accept that, hold myself accountable, and then make myself better. That's just something that you've got to be as good as you can possibly be, and you've got to work towards that end. That was Vince Lombardi's big deal. You know, winning isn't the only thing. It's the preparation to win is what he was talking about. And whether if you've done everything you can to prepare to make yourself the best coach, the best athlete, the best defensive back, the best baseball player that you can be, how can you fail? You can't. You may not be the guy that's up here number one and winning the Heisman Trophy, but you do know that I've done everything in my power, and I've got the passion to do the best that I can with the abilities that I've been given.
That effort, it sounds like, is what gives you like the mental peace, right? Of like, I did what I could. I went 100% at this.
Absolutely. It absolutely is that. And high school was a great learning experience because I was the best in high school. There was nobody better than me. And when I went to Notre Dame, what a humbling experience that became. Because you're thinking as a high school kid that you're going to walk on to Notre Dame football team and you're going to be an All-American. OMG. I mean, it was one of those things that soon – and I had to deal with it, you know, and my spirituality rose from it. You know, being able to sit down in a quiet space and talk to your higher power, so to speak, to be able to quiet your mind again, to be able to accept the consequences of your behavior, so to speak, of your ego, of your actions. And so you can either put your tail between your legs and accept that and you go nowhere, or you can fight on to become the best that you can possibly be. And you hope that the results will be what you want them to be, but you understand that they may not be. However, you've done everything in your power to make it happen, so you can't lose.
I love that, Mike. Is there what if people could take away one thing from this episode, one thing you want them to walk away with and maybe think about and or implement, does anything stand out to you?
I think that if whatever it is that you're going to attack, whether it's football, baseball, basketball, track, CrossFit, it makes no difference. Whatever it is that you're going to do, that you put it in your brain housing group to be the best at it that you can possibly be. And if you want to, if you're a person that right now needs to lose 100 pounds, well, frick, put it in your dadgum brain housing group and come up with a plan, study the plan, and by God, lose 100 pounds. What is the best way for me to do that? Well, I'm going to quit eating. That's baloney. You need to study what it is that's going to make you, and you can accept to lose that 100 pounds, and then go lose 100 pounds. You know, I mean, if it's diet, go through your cupboard and see what's bad, see what's good, and that's what's bad, throw it out, and what's good, keep, and then shop accordingly. But you have to make that commitment, and I think that's the most important part, is knowing and understanding and to make the commitment to achieve the goals that you're putting forth. And if you're going to set the goals, you're going to put that goal out there, then make the commitment to achieve that particular goal and study to do it.
Yeah, I really appreciate you, of course, for all of the, you know, sport specific and the knowledge that you bring around training and competing and all of that. But I think more so than that, I appreciate just a lot of what you have given us today that you can take into your lifestyle and day-to-day life, you know, and there's a lot of carryover into the way that you can just kind of live on a day-to-day basis, attacking whatever it is that you want to. So thank you for that.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that.
Where can we point people to and how can we support you? You know, where can people keep up with what you're doing and learn more?
Well, there's a couple places. First of all, my email address is Mike Burgener, B-U-R-G-E-N-E-R, at mac.com. You contact me there. I answer all emails. My text is 760-535-1835. That's my phone as well. You can call me and, hey, coach, this is John Doe from Hampton, Virginia, and I got a question. Can you talk? And I'll say, well, I can't talk now, or yeah, I can talk. I got a free moment. You know, I'm retired. Absolutely. And, you know, my wife is kind of like a yard Nazi. I always say that. And so she wants me working in the yard when I'm not working with what I do. So don't hesitate to contact me. We have Bergner Strength and CrossFit Weightlifting on, you know, separate websites. And Bergner Strength is also a YouTube now that my daughter's putting out there to show, she'll interview me on, you know, technique and stuff like that. And so we have YouTube courses, if you want, or YouTube clips of how to correct certain movement patterns. By all means, subscribe to it. It, you know, helps, it will help you out. And, you know, and again, don't hesitate to contact me and, you know, I'll get back to you as I can.
Well, thank you so much for being generous with your time, and I really enjoyed this conversation and would love to do it again sometime.
Anytime you want, just let me know.
Awesome. Well, thanks again, Mike.
Take care.
Thank you so much for listening. I appreciate you lending me your ears. Before you head out, I wanted to share a free gift with you. It's only available for podcast listeners at mizhq.com. Again, that's mizhq.com. So go ahead and grab that. If you want to support the show, the best compliment that you can give is by leaving a review with your thoughts. You have no idea how much that helps, and I always love hearing from you guys. So once again, thank you again for tuning in. Until next time.